Good evening and welcome to another edition of Medicine in the News. I'm your host, Dr. Lee Radosh. Well, it's hard to think of a topic that's made the news more with regard to healthcare and medicine in recent months than healthcare reform and all the bills that were enacted, all the debate, all the partisan rhetoric. And now, what do? How do we interpret all that's happened? Well, in the next half hour, we're going to try to look at some of these complex issues and specifically talk about medical assistance and how healthcare reform relates to that. And I'm very pleased to have as my guest Jonathan Encarnacion, who is currently the Director of Strategic Partnerships and Development at University of Pittsburgh Medical Center, UPMC, in a local 12-county region. And he's going to explain to us in a little bit exactly what that's about. Jonathan is really no stranger, obviously, to the healthcare needs of Berks County and Reading. He's volunteered in so many positions throughout Reading for so many years as the Executive Director of the Hispanic Center in downtown Reading, board member of Alvernia University, and just so many other expertise and experience. So during the show, I really want to tap into his just perspectives on what we need to do in Reading and Berks County, in addition to his new role. So again, John, thank you so much for, I know you're a busy guy, and thanks for being here.
No, thank you so much, Dr. Radosh. I think this is a great opportunity, not only for me, but also to explain to the viewers exactly what UPMC Health Plan is all about, and also the fact that there are some new plans in Berks County, and we need to explain how all that plays within the healthcare reform as well.
And that's terrific. And let's start off a general question. There's so much confusion in healthcare with terms like Medicare, Medicaid, medical assistance. Can you talk a little bit about what is medical assistance? What is Medicaid?
Sure. The applying obviously of Medicaid, to be able to apply for Medicaid, you must qualify based on income, and of course depending on where you fall within the tables that they have for levels of poverty, the government may or may not actually approve your insurance based on your income and the size of your family. Something I think that the viewers need to be aware of is that there are various new plans right now in Berks County. Mm-hmm. One of them is UPMC, and I believe that also Aetna mm-hmm. is new into town. So for those individuals who recently applied through the Department of Welfare, because this is a program that is managed by Pennsylvania's Department of Welfare, mm-hmm. there ultimately is the entity that actually pays the insurance premium so that a private insurer can actually provide that level of care to the member. So many folks who have already recently have applied, they probably have received a letter already indicating that their insurer is either UPMC or Aetna. And what they need to do is they need to call an 800 number. There's an organization out there called Maximus, mm-hmm. which is operating on behalf of the Department of Welfare. And they'll be able basically to tell the new member what are the options that they have, what is the plethora of services and insurance companies. I believe in Berks County right now, I think there's about five different options.
Sounds about right.
That they have. And ultimately, it's going to be the member's decision to determine what is their best plan. However, if they do not call or if they do not make the decisions known, the government then will elect a plan for them automatically. And then it's their responsibility ongoing, because they do have a choice, I believe it's every month, they have the option of actually change to a different plan or a different insurer.
Okay, so basically medical assistance or Medicaid is really a state-supported insurance, and if someone, based on their financial needs, family situation, qualifies,
correct.
Well, what they do is they apply through the DPW,
Department of Welfare. Yes.
If they qualify, then they will get a list of private insurers
correct.
That will take them. And currently in Berks County, as you and I were talking before, we think there's about five, and I think it's important to mention, so AmeriHealth, Mercy, mm-hmm. Gateway, Unison, UPMC, which mm-hmm. is new, and Aetna. And those are private insurers, and people
correct.
Need to understand that. Those are not state. Those
correct.
Are private insurers who are getting money from the state to take care of patients.
That's correct. And something that is, I think it's important to mention, because this is a major change from what things used to be. I think in the past, an insurance company used to market directly to the consumer mm-hmm. In terms of basically selling, what are the differences in terms of quality of the plan versus another insurance company. That's no longer the case. The Department of Welfare does not permit an insurance company marketing directly to the consumer,
really?
Which means that the responsibility is on the side of the consumer to educate themselves. And also to ask questions, because the plans can be different, mm-hmm. and sometimes the co-pays can be different,
wow.
which means that there are certain things that are not paid 100%. You still may have to pay $5 for perhaps a prescription drug, so you may have to pay $10 or $20 for eyeglasses, things of that sort. So it is important that the consumer there is educated and understands that they have an option of calling the Department of Welfare or calling Maximus and really get an understanding as to what it is they're getting.
And also, from a physician or provider standpoint, I know that different providers accept different insurances for
Correct.
Better or worse, and unfortunately, it shifts a lot,
right.
Or
right.
it has traditionally,
right.
and that's always been a problem,
right.
and I think people need to be aware of that.
The other thing I want to emphasize is that many families also, perhaps sometimes, if they don't qualify for Medicaid, there is such a thing called CHIP, mm-hmm. which is insurance for children. And that matrix is completely different than that of Medicaid. And also the CHIP program is administered by the Department of Insurance, not by DPW.
Oh, okay.
So if a family has applied for Medicaid and has been turned down, there's still an option. And their income can be, again, there's some limitations in terms of income. Well, you could actually be a full-time, have a full-time job, make a decent wage, and the government may even allow you to subsidize your payment for CHIP. So that just don't think that because you don't qualify for Medicaid doesn't mean that your children have to go along without insurance.
So that's a great point that people need to realize that there may be a lot of options available beyond
Correct.
Medical assistance.
Correct.
One thing that we were talking about a little before the program, and also I should mention, if anyone has any questions or comments on this topic, please call us at 610-378-0426, is that in my experience, there's a lot of myths regarding medical assistance and who gets medical assistance, who should get medical assistance, and it's frankly upsetting mm-hmm. because especially with the economy as it is, and can you comment on your experience with that about who you see getting medical assistance and who needs it and really
sure.
who should be applying for it?
Sure. In fact, I think the issue really when we get down to it, and I have seen a lot of data, especially in the city of Reading, just to give an example, the last set of data that I looked at is that when you look at zip code 19601, mm-hmm. which is probably primarily where BCTV is located right now, mm-hmm. we have about 45% of all the families in the county that qualify for cash assistance.
Wow.
And then beyond that, if you look at the boundaries of the city of Reading, it accounts for about 85% of all the families that qualify for cash assistance. So this is a problem that really impacts a lot of people. And, there are some myths about it because a lot of folks think that these are not working folks. A lot of them are working folks.
Right.
They tend to be underemployed, meaning right. that they're not making enough money.
They have a part-time job.
And they have a part-time job. But when you get to the core of who they are, it's what they call the feminization of poverty. Mm-hmm. It's really mothers who have children who are struggling to get educated, who are struggling to get job training, to get some skills, so that ultimately they can get the kind of a job needed and earn the type of wage needed to support not only the children, but also to be able to afford insurance.
Right.
Because keep in mind that just because you have a full-time job doesn't mean that you can afford to pay the premium for a good
right.
coverage for your family.
And I'm sure most of our viewers can relate to that and have seen that. And you bring up some excellent points about this sort of a cycle. And one of the things that I've seen a lot is what's very sort of wrong about our system, and I think it's no secret, is that if you are very poor and could qualify for yeah. medical assistance, one of the problems is that if you work and get some part, just even a little bit of money, not enough to live on,
right.
but just a little, and then you may not qualify. And how do we, what can we do to sort of break that cycle? I mean, that's a big question, but is that something you've seen in your experience? Or?
Oh, absolutely. And I think I'm a believer, even since when I spent my years as executive director of the Hispanic Center, that I believe that we need to invest. If ultimately, we're going to look at the impact, the financial impact that that could have in any city or in any society. The alternative of not investing those dollars, especially in health, ultimately is going to really cost us a lot of money. Early on in my career, I was involved actually in a drug and alcohol prevention program. And we were able to determine that for every dollar that we spend on prevention, we could save $1.75.
Wow.
So there are some numbers behind, what can be done in having ultimately a healthier community. And we also have to point out that when you look at the data, when you look at the research, poor people, because of the fact of their financial situation, because of how they eat, ultimately could also impact the overall cost of healthcare, not only to you and I, as taxpayers, but also to those individuals who are accessing health care. So this is something that is going to affect everyone. It's not just the person that cannot afford to have a full-time job. It's also you and I, you know, who are paying taxes.
Right.
And, you know, what affects one individual is really ultimately going to affect the entire city.
And it must have been, you know, with your experience with this, it must have been kind of frustrating watching all these debates go on
right.
with health care reform, people, frankly, burying their head in the sand about the impact of care now, or I should say lack of care now, mm-hmm. down the road. And, you know, I always wonder what can we do to educate people about that. And
right.
It's must be a hard question.
Absolutely. And I think when it comes to health care, especially at the national level, you know, I often say that you have to really look at the definition of insanity. And I define insanity as doing the same thing, expecting a different result.
Right.
So obviously, I think something had to be done about health care in the United States. We are lagging behind compared to some other internationally developed countries. So I think we have taken a step perhaps in the right direction. There's a lot more that needs to be done. But there's no doubt in my mind that this is something that ultimately, if we don't take action, is going to break the backs of small businesses
right.
who are suffering right now and struggling to get to get coverage for their employees, and also small nonprofit organizations that have to pay incredible premiums, you know, to be able to continue to work and do the kind of work that they do in the community. So again, I think this is the kind of thing that it really impacts everyone, not just large corporations, but also small businesses.
It's a big issue. I think what we're going to do is we're going to take a quick station break here at BCTV, and then we'll be back in just a moment with more discussion.
You're watching Medicine in the News on BCTV.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information about your community and other health-related stories, go to bctv.org. Medicine in the News on bctv.org is underwritten by the Reading Hospital and Medical Center. For more information on how you and your business can become a program underwriter, go to bctv.org.
Okay, good evening and welcome back to our discussion tonight on Medicine in the News. I'm your host, Dr. Lee Radosh, and with me is my guest, Jonathan Encarnacion, who is the Director of Strategic Partnerships and Development at UPMC for our local 12-county region. And we're talking about healthcare reform and specifically about some of the newer medical assistance programs, the program that Jonathan's going to speak about as an example of this, and how this is impacting some of the changes. And before we started, Jonathan, I was asking about your new role. And as a family physician, I really believe I understand the importance of community
right.
and what happens when a patient leaves the hospital in the office,
right.
how that impacts that patient's health care. And it sounds like the plan that you are representing is really trying to understand that and affect that. So if you want to talk a little bit about your role and what UPMC is and is doing.
Sure, absolutely. It's been said that it takes a village to raise a child. And I think that the same principle can really apply to healthcare. It's not just the responsibility of government or the responsibility of an insurance company to manage the care of an individual. I think we all have to take responsibility. The member has to take responsibility. The community has to take responsibility. The private sector has to take responsibility. So part of my job as the person that has to go out there and basically, based on especially my background, working for a nonprofit organization for 11 years, is that we're looking at nonprofit community-based, grassroots-based type of organizations that have a similar vision and relationship as that of UPMC in terms of the type of work that they do in the community, connect with those organizations in making sure that we are delivering the type of education and information that is needed so that ultimately I think the community can profit from it. In fact, if we can get the slide up, I can expand a little bit further on that topic. This is basically a diagram that explains some of the companies that are owned by UPMC Health Plan.
Right.
All the way at the bottom, you can see the company that's called Community Care.
Right
Community Care is the behavioral health insurance company here in Berks County. Unlike physical health, behavioral health only has one insurance company per county. So basically, if anyone needs behavioral health care, they have to go through Community Care, and this is an organization that has a contract with the county, Department of Mental Health, Mental Retardation, to be able to provide that level of service and care. The point that I want to make is that a number of years ago, when I was at the Hispanic Center, UPMC Community Care partnered with the Hispanic Center to bring the very first Latino Behavioral Health Summit to the county, in collaboration also with the county Department of Mental Health and Mental Retardation. Right. This is an example where basically UPMC and Community Care were saying, we need to understand where some of the issues are affecting the Latino community. So we were not assuming that we knew what's best for the community, but rather
really talk to the community.
Exactly.
And
Let's talk to the community. Right. Let's engage the community. Let's bring the experts. But more important, let's look at some best practices out there so that we're not reinventing the wheel. Let's look at those communities that have
combine
figured out
what's been done and what can match to the needs of the community.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I have to tell you, Dr. Radosh, that we really got a lot of attention from the Department of Welfare at the state level. They really liked the kind of work that has been done in Berks County. The level of support, I think, that we're getting from the county as well, because I think we have a county administrator that is very proactive, that is very progressive, and really understands what it means to do preventive work, what it means to really increase quality of and access to services. Right. The other item, if I may
mention,
yeah, go ahead.
We're going to come back to, I think we just have a caller, so I just want to get to the caller. Then I want to come back to the issue of the partnerships particularly.
Sure.
I think we have a caller, and if so, good evening. Welcome to Medicine in the News.
Yeah, good evening. I'm calling to make a comment about the conversation here as far as Medicaid and such. Mm-hmm. It seems to me that once a person gets into Medicaid, it's very hard to get out of it if you want to take the direction of, doing something for yourself, like going out to work or making an investment with, monies that you have. Say you buy an apartment building and you would get income from that. If you still have a catastrophic disease, which in my case I do, I can't pay for the medication, but I can pay for, the 20% above what the Medicare would give me. It's very hard to get out of the process once you get in it, and that's where I found myself. I got an inheritance, and what do I do with that inheritance? Do I invest it, or make the choice to put it in a special needs trust to protect it? And that's where I found myself. My medication to keep me alive is $5,000 a month.
Wow.
And I wanted to get out of that process, but I couldn't. So it seems to me if there was a little bit of an a la carte type of situation with, the state subsidy, I think that maybe cost could be reduced if you looked at a case-by-case basis.
I think
very clearly this health bill had to pass.
Right, just because it's such a broken system. And, I think, caller, I'm so sorry about your situation, and I think you're exactly right. You're touching on some of the things that Jonathan and I were discussing before, this issue of sort of the almost like a cycle and being trapped, and it's such a have or have not instead of really looking at the situation, what would be best financially in your situation for not just you but for everyone in taxpayers. And Jonathan, can you comment on this? This is a sort of a sad that it's typical scenario about someone who has such high medical costs because what can we do to help the situation?
No, absolutely. I think that, and I certainly empathize with the situation because it's really a catch-22. And I think that he's not, in a unique position. I think there's a lot of folks out there that find themselves in a very similar situation. And to a certain extent, I think that's what finally got politicians to really begin to focus on changes to the healthcare system. At least the way I understand it in terms of the history, I think this goes back probably prior to Nixon.
Oh, yeah,
and I think during the Nixon administration, there was a strong push. I think we thought at the time that it was going to pass, but then at the end, it really collapsed. And I think it's important to understand that the changes that have taken place, it's just the tip of the iceberg.
Right.
I mean, we really have not gone perhaps as far as that we need to go in clarifying some of the situations and, again, looking at the type of options that people need to have with respect to, having private insurance.
Yeah, great. Well, thank you for your call.
Well, thank you.
Appreciate it. It's just so such a reminder, like you said, about why this had to pass and why the callers mentioned that this had to pass, this complex legislation.
Right. One of the things that I wanted to highlight, in fact, I mean, going back to the community care with behavioral health and then also having UPMC also providing physical health, which I think it goes back to an extent, I mean, not exactly what the caller was talking about, but part of the reason that I think why healthcare sometimes is expensive is that many times there's a lack of coordination in terms of services. And in cases where you have an individual who's receiving treatment because of a mental illness, and at the same time he's also receiving treatment because of a physical illness, many times there's a disconnect between the physical health and the mental health treatment of that individual. In Allegheny County, UPMC actually started a pilot program that's called Connected Care. And the whole idea would be to increase the flow of information, because right now there's a lot of stuff out there that's digital. And it's very easily, as a physician, I'm sure you probably know that by now, that you can actually send files back and forth to another doctor or another hospital or another clinic. But the whole idea would be that if you have a patient that is on taking some psychotropic drugs, what are the effects? How do they interact with all the medication that this individual might be taking because of a physical illness? And I think that's important because ultimately, if the patient is in worst case, it's going to cost not only you, the patient, but also us, again, and the taxpayer, and the whole system is going to be taxed even more to the point that it's going to be broken. The other point that I want to make real quickly is that we also need to focus on the use of the emergency room.
Right, and that's a particular problem with people who are underinsured
because
of lack of access.
That is correct.
So what are some things we can do?
That is correct. I think the key there is education, and especially, you know, I think when we talk about the immigrant community, looking at folks who are coming from Latin America, of course, the medical system, the access of care in Latin America is very different from that of the United States. And I think we need to focus on the whole issue of acculturation. Mm-hmm. You know, for that immigrant population coming here to the United States, we need to educate and making sure that people understand that this is a new system that has different rules, and that you don't necessarily have to go to the ER all the time, that if you can rely on your primary physician and rely on that individual to guide you and sort of coordinate the access to health, ultimately, again, it's going to be much cheaper for everyone involved, and ultimately everyone will be able to receive better care.
And one of the, I guess, ironies with that, is, as you know, is that some of the biggest people who are against any kind of health care change would say, oh, we shouldn't pay for more than we have to. But as you and I know, like you said, it's so much more expensive for that person to end up in the ER. So I think we look at sort of these pilot projects, pilot programs out there in different arenas, whether it's mental health like you're doing in Allegheny County, to look for some data to say it saves money and it works. But it's hard to do that first, you know, push there to, to do that. You know, one of the things you talked about was that the issue of behavioral health and physical health, and that's been one of the challenges in our healthcare system, frankly, as a family physician. I sometimes have trouble getting records because of HIPAA laws and other things, and and it sounds like certainly UPMC is being proactive at that. Are there some other things UPMC is doing in terms of mental health? You said that they really are partnering with local agencies to find out what best meets the needs of the community.
Oh, absolutely. I think one of the other innovative programs that are taking place in Allegheny County, which I, because of my bias being from this area, want to bring it to Berks County. But one of the programs that they have, I think, that's working very well is actually working with the local children and youth services, children that are in foster care. Because, again, if we're looking at investment, that's the place to start.
Absolutely.
You know, let's not wait until someone is really chronically ill, but let's begin at the let's take it at the beginning, you know, at a stage when we can actually have an impact. But the program, the way it works is that we look at the data, and we look at the number of claims that a child or an individual had within a year's time. And we want to make sure that we're looking at how often has the child been to a doctor for an annual physical. We look at immunizations. We look at different variables in terms of high blood pressure, cholesterol, so on and so forth. And if there's any kind of treatment or screenings that is missing, we go back and talk to the social worker at CYS and making sure that that treatment or that screening is followed. Because to the extent that the child can access the services, you know, at the beginning it could be just a simple screening. If we neglect that, it's going to be a visit to the ER, and guess who's going to pay for that?
Right, absolutely.
And actually, it's everyone.
If we could show a slide in the last couple of minutes, I just want to show a couple of slides that really brings to home the idea of prevention.
Yeah.
Geisinger Health System nearby has gotten a lot of national accolades about some of the work they've done in doing exactly what you're saying, is let's put the money up front.
Right.
And they put in a very robust health system where they pay for care, and sure enough, They've shown that they've really reduced hospital admissions. Anyone who's ever stepped foot in a hospital knows that just that stepping the foot in, how expensive that is. Readmission numbers going down, and I'm going through these quickly in the interest of time, and just how they cut readmissions so much, on some sites as much as 90%. You know, this concept of putting money up front. Along those lines, the idea of paying for sort of preventive care. And is there some things that, like, you're finding that UPMC, the new plan, is doing for preventive care in our last minute or so?
Oh, absolutely. I think one of the things that we're doing, especially in other counties, which, again, ultimately I hope that we can bring to Berks County, but is paying nonprofit organizations to provide a level of education to bring what they call promotores, which is sort of like a patient navigator, because again we have to understand that the medical system is complex.
Very.
And sometimes even navigating, I hate to say that, but even navigating and talking to an insurance company may not be the easiest thing to do. So we are actually partnering with nonprofit organizations that have these promotoras, these ladies that go out and actually work with the members, work with the patients, and making sure not only that they're getting access to care, but that the quality of the access to care is there, because ultimately a healthier member is going to be a much cheaper healthcare system for everyone involved.
And reducing duplication,
so
that navigator can say, hey, this doctor recommended you do this test. You already just had that.
Correct.
Would save a lot of money.
That's right.
Well, I think, as is often thinking, we're just about out of time, and we've only barely even scratched the surface of the surface, I'd say, with this complex topic. But I want to mostly thank our guest, Jonathan Encarnacion, again, the Director of Strategic Partnerships and Development at UPMC, and really an exciting new health plan that I know that in my office at Reading Hospital and Reading Hospitals being a partner with. And thank you so much for your time
and your
interest and background in this. And certainly thanks to our viewers. And look to us again. This has been Medicine in the News. Thanks and good evening.